Hi, today we are going to discuss about modeling multiple PCB boards inside Sherlock. These boards can be offset at any particular orientation. Then we are going to take the multiple boards from Sherlock to Workbench Mechanical, and we are going to assemble these boards inside an enclosure. In this particular case, the enclosure looks like this, and the enclosure is having some openings. There is a parting on one side of the enclosure. Like this side of the enclosure is kind of fully parted, and some of the components are inside the parting and some components are outside the parting. This whole region is kind of a parting region here we are going to talk about, what you are seeing in a green color. Then we are going to assume this enclosure is attached to a frame which is relatively rigid, and the entire frame is subjected to vibration excitation. So we are going to carry out a harmonic analysis, and we are going to look at the mode shapes and the vibration pattern of the boards. Then the vibration and stress response on the enclosure. Finally, we are going to take the harmonic analysis results from Workbench Mechanical back into Sherlock for the life calculation, and we are going to assess the life curve of different components on both of these PCBs. To model multiple boards inside Sherlock, we need to use a sub-assembly procedure. I'm going to demonstrate this simple procedure by taking one of the PCB board that comes along with the Sherlock installation tutorials. Assume that this is board 1 and the board 2 is at some distance and at some angle with respect to board 1. So in order to assemble these two boards in a particular configuration, I'm going to use two helper boards. These two helper boards are used as a dummy boards for orienting these two boards in a desired location. But when we do the analysis of the entire board plus enclosure system, these two boards are not accounted in the analysis. So I'm going to go through the actual steps involved in this process. Let's start. Let us start with a blank Sherlock project. First, I will set the working directory is a very blank directory. I'm using this as my current project directory. Then I'm going to import the board that comes with Sherlock installation tutorials. Board. Import ODBRK. I'm just going to import the example scan RK. Okay, import RK. So now the first board is imported. Then on this same project, I'm going to add one more circuit card. I'm going to name this as board 2. In this, I'm going to import a ODB file. For this example purpose, I'm going to use the same board twice, but in the actual scenario, it may be a different board as well. You can import some other board. Scan RK. Okay, import RK. So this is my second board now. Now we are having two boards here. The board one looks like this. Both there are parts at the top side and bottom side. Now this case I have imported the same boards twice, board one and board two. Okay, so this board is of size approximately, we can measure the board size. This is approximately 190 by 115 mm. So now I'm going to create the first helper board, odd circuit card. I'm going to say this as helper 1. On this helper 1 board, I'm going to define the new layout. So I'm going to define the board of length 200 by 150. This is some approximate dimension. We will see the use of this later. This is the board that I have created. As I have explained earlier, the first PCB 1 is going to come and sit here. I'm going to create a reference point for this. For that assembly purpose, first I'm going to create one mount point. Edit, edit mount points, right click, add mount point. I'm going to create a mount pad. The mount pad is of circular cross section and 10 mm. This location is my 0, 0. So I'm going to offset this little bit. By 10, and instead of circular I can choose a rectangular. This is kind of a dummy board. We will not be using this for any purpose. I'm just going to create one point to kind of align the PCB 1 on this board, and we can give some height just for visualization purpose. Let's say 20, then say save. Now we can see a new mount point has come in here. Now we are going to create this corner of the PCB board has to come and sit on the mount point that we have created. So on PCB 1, we are going to create another mount pad, input files, layers, edit. Edit mount point, odd mount point. We are going to create the mount pad. For doing the assembly, we must create a mount pad, the bottom side of the board. Let me say I'm going to offset this by 50 mm height, and this is going to be a circular pad. of 20. This has to come and sit in this corner. For that purpose, initially I'm going to make this at 0, 0. This means it will come and sit in the center. These axes represents the 0, 0. See, it's somewhere here. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to move this point such that it come and sit in this center. Apply. Now it will say it's outside the board outline. That's okay, because this is a dummy mount point. We will not be using this for any purpose. Having this done, now come back to board 1 and say edit assemblies, add assembly, bring board 1, and the center can be anywhere. There are two types of cord assembly. One is mezzanine and another one is edge connector. For this one, we are going to use the mezzanine cord. So which cord among the two cords? First, we are going to bring in board 1. Save. Now you see that the board 1 has come here. Now you can shift and select this board and bring these two mount points somewhere here like this. Then you can select only the mount point on PCB 1 and right click, say add assembly point. Now say apply. Now let's go and look at how this assembled board is going to look like. To do that, come to any one of your analysis. For example, here I'm choosing natural frequency analysis, view 3D results. Sorry, not view 3D results, view generate 3D model. Now we can say view generated model and say save. Now this is going to generate back to this one. Edit mount point, select this point by using shift and left click, edit properties. Instead of this diameter being 10, make it as something like 2. Now make this mount point to go little inside this one and make this little small. Close. You can exactly position this by selecting this mount point. Right click, say edit properties. So we can exactly specify what should be its location. Close. Now let's come back here, natural frequency, generate 3D model, say. This is going to build a 3D CAD model of the printed circuit board that we have imported here. It looks like this now. Again, now we can go and look the helper 1 3D assembly, because this helper 1, if we look at, as we have assembled, there are two things going to be here. we have to again adjust this point such that it sits at the appropriate location. Now let's also visualize the 3D model for this helper 1. So now this is going to contain the base helper board. On top of it, PCB 1 is going to sit. Something like this. Okay, so this height is nothing but the mount point height 50 mm that we created for PCB 1. This is the one that we created for this helper board, 20 mm height. Now it is possible to rotate this card on this plane. Only in the in-plane direction it can be rotated. It cannot be rotated something like this or like this. It can be rotated only in the plane of this PCB one. To do that, we have to go back to these layers and edit assemblies, select this board and say edit properties. We can specify any angle. Let's say, for example, I'm saying 30 degrees, say. You see this get rotated, but this rotation is possible only in the plane, not possible to rotate about this line or rotate about this line, something like this. Okay, I just want to demonstrate this. We will be using this concept later. Okay, now we have assembled this board. If we go back here, the other board has to be on the left side of this board. So here we have only small space. We don't have enough space here to assign this. So what we can do, we can go and extend this helper board for some more length along this direction. To do that, edit board outline, edit outline, select this point and move this point, both the points. Now we can edit location. We can say, for example, my Y has to be 0, my X can be something like -200, and this edit point, my X one y is 150 and this is -200. So now we got the bigger board done. Now I'm going to create the helper 2 card, odd circuit card, say helper 2, save. I'm going to define the layout. Again, these are dummy boards. Depending on the height at which we are going to put this board, we need to give the dimension. This width may not be really of importance to us. So for this case, I'm going to choose something like 20 and 50. So this board is going to something look like this. Now we can also go and adjust this stack up. By default, it's going to have a 3-layer stack up. The total thickness is 1.575 mm. But for my easy assembly purpose, I'm going to make this as total of 2 mm thickness. I'm going to change the top layer and bottom layer as 0.5 mm and middle layer as 1 mm, such that the total thickness becomes 2 mm. Once we have 2 mm, the calculating the distance and offsets becomes easy. Okay, we are not going to use any of these properties. These are all just for the assembly purpose. Okay, now we have done this. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to go back to the helper one. Okay, I think, didn't I save? I think I haven't saved this changes that we made here in terms of the board outline, edit outline, make minus 200, 150, this one, minus 200, 0. Okay, done. Okay, all right. Now what we are going to do, we are going to assemble helper 2 on top of this helper 1. So edit assemblies, add assembly. Now this time I'm going to assemble board 2 on top of board 1. So the way I assemble is this supposed to be minus 120 and this one is 50. Now this time this helper 2 card is not parallel to helper 1. Like if you look at the PCB 1, the PCB 1 is parallel to helper 1, but this helper 2 is not parallel to helper 1. In fact, this is kind of perpendicular. To do this kind of orientation, we have to use edge connector rather than the default one. So I'm going to use this edge connector, and the bottom edge has to be aligned with this card. Now I'm going to we have to delete this assembly or reset odd assembly, not board 2. We have to assign the helper, not the board 2. This is minus 120 and this is 75, the edge connector and the bottom edge. See, now you can see that this helper 2 is sitting on top of helper 1. Let's have a 3D view of this model for better understanding purpose. Natural frequency analysis, generate 3D model, and look at this. So this is my helper 2 sitting on top of helper 1. Now we have to assemble the other PCB on top of this somewhere here and rotate that card. Let's go back and see this. Originally, the PCB is going to come and sit something like this, then we are going to rotate it by some angle. Okay, that's what we are going to do. So first let us get PCB 2 on helper 2 card. To do that, we have to do this subassembly on helper 2. Now let's go to helper 2 layer, edit assemblies, odd assembly. Here we are going to odd board 2, and again here the board 2 is not going to be parallel to helper 2. It should be perpendicular to board 2, something like this. Board 2 and helper 2 and PCB 2 are perpendicular, so we have to use the edge connector. And another point you have to notice is that the component on the PCB 2 are pointing down, whereas in PCB 1 it's pointing up. So in order to make this point down, we have to make the board side as bottom here. And this one, the PCB 2 is going to sit on the top edge somewhere here, and the location where it has to sit is on the Y. It has to go and sit on exactly on the top, right? So this total height is 50 and X 0. It is going to, X is 0. This is going to be our reference point. We will be doing all the rotations with respect to this reference point. Let's have a look. Let's say save. Now you see this is coming and exactly sitting here. Now we have to rotate by some angle. So we have to rotate this by 20 degrees to achieve the desired orientation. Now it is going to be like this. Now let's save this. Now understand this carefully. PCB 2 is sitting on helper 2, but helper 2 is sitting on helper 1. Now if we come back and see the layer of helper 1, we don't see the PCB 2 sitting on helper 1, but if we generate the 3D model, we should able to see the PCB 2 and PCB 1 sitting on a particular orientation. Let's have a look before we proceed further. Now you see this here, okay, and there is a some offset as well, but if we look in our original assembly, this supposed to be like this. This jack and this jack need to be on the same side so that they can be connected here. But now if we look at this, the jack is somewhere here and this is somewhere here. So in order to do that, what we are going to do is we are going to rotate this entire helper 2 by 180 degrees such that it will rotate like this. Let's have a look. Let's go to helper 1, layers, edit assemblies, select this assembly, edit properties. Let's say this as 180 degree. Say apply, close. Now let's generate the 3D model for this new configuration. You see, earlier it was like this. By rotating this about this for 180 degree, then we will get this particular way of the assembly. This is how actual our 3D assembly is. This board is this side and the components are pointing down. This board is on another side and the components are pointing up. So now we have kind of correctly oriented this. I understand Today we are using more sophisticated CAD tools where we can assemble and offset the different components in assembly in much simpler way. But here we have to precisely calculate the offset distances and angle. We have to use some kind of a trigonometric relationship well in advance. This may be a little bit non-conventional to the new users, but people who have been using CAE for a long time, probably for more than 15-20 years, earlier doing the assembly inside any FEA analysis is not easy, so we have to do all these trigonometry calculations in advance to assemble the different parts at desired location. So using this kind of a logic, it is possible to build different types of configuration. Just for example, I want to show some flavors here. First, let us discuss this scenario. There are two boats at some angle, but they are all not at the same height. They are at different height. So if you want to achieve this kind of a configuration, what we can do is we can create the helper chord, the first helper chord. On this helper chord, we can edge connect the one PCB, then assemble one more helper chord 2, on top of this helper 1. Then you edge connect the another PCB on top of this helper 2. Here we can individually rotate these two boats in the in-plane direction such that we can achieve something like this kind of a configuration. Here is another example where this is the master PCB. On top of that, there is another PCB sitting connected through some screws, and also there are two more graphics card kind of edge connected on this. So these types of different configurations are possible using this sub-assembly procedure. There is also a help manual on this. If you go to Sherlock installation directory, let me go to a old versions. I do not have help manual for 2021 R1 Sherlock. If you go to user guides, there is a guide about sub-assembly analysis, FEA 14 sub-assembly analysis. This kind of discuss the step-by-step procedure and how we can do the assembly and interpret the results and so on. Have a look at this user guide for some more insights. Okay, now we are done with this, but another important thing we have to consider is that the parting. So the parting kind of covers, let me show in the FE model itself. This is an analysis which I have already completed. I'm going to reproduce this. So if you look at this part of the assembly, this let me hide these faces. Hide faces. Oops. Hide faces. Hide faces. Okay, let me go with this. F8. Okay, so this part of the enclosure is split into two chambers like this. This entire chamber is filled with some kind of a potting. Let me bring up the potting here, show body. If I kind of cut this section, I think we can understand this better. You see, some pots are inside the potting and some tall components are protruding outside the potting. This potting is not just on the PCB length. This is covering the entire enclosure. So creating a potting which is beyond the PCB board is something not possible inside Sherlock. So what we are going to do is we are going to create a dummy potting in an arbitrary location. Then once we come inside mechanical, we will suppress the dummy potting. We will use our own potting geometry for that. For that purpose, I'm again going to board 1 layers. I'm going to create a potting at arbitrary location. This will be replaced at later. So edit potting regions, add potting region. This is potting region 1. We can say potting thickness, say whatever it is. That's not important to us because we are going to replace this. Some dummy geometry, make somewhere here. It's going to come here. Then move this somewhere inside. Okay. As I'm mentioning, the location and the size is really not important, but the material is important. We can choose what potting material we are going to use here. That's available from Sherlock library. As I mentioned, the location of this potting is not important because we will be suppressing this potting geometry in mechanical and replacing with the actual potting area. But the material is important. We can choose the appropriate material and the potting ID is given as a PR1. Now say, oops, the dimension need to be adjusted. See, save. And we can close this. As we see here, there are many small components on this assembly, but in order to limit the parts that needs to be exported into FEA, what I'm going to do is on this analysis, natural frequency analysis, edit properties, I'm going to say export parts which are more than 5 mm in size. Don't export all the parts. This is running this analysis. I don't want to run the analysis. Just stop this analysis. Rather say generate 3D model and view 3D model. See, there are some parts are kind of suppressed. This is the potting that we have created. For same way, just to differentiate between the PCB1 and PCB2, for PCB2, we are going to, for board 2, we are going to set, consider the parts which are more than 10 mm in the analysis. So now if we come and see the final model for both PCB 1 and PCB 2, we would see more parts present in PCB 1, because any part more than 5 mm is considered here. But on PCB 2, any parts more than 10 mm only considered here. Okay, for all practical purposes, you can imagine these as completely two different PCB boards oriented at some arbitrary location. Now we are done with this. The next step is to export this entire assembly into mechanical to assemble this inside enclosure and update the parting. Again, this helper one in this whole project is called master board. To export all the boards into workbench mechanical, we have to export a system which is master board. Okay, in this case it is helper one, and say export FEA model, save this inside the working directory. I'm just going to save here and say two board angle underscore one workbench journal file. Now what this is going to do is it's going to create a workbench script file, and it is going to export the step file of the all the boards and the components, and it will automatically open a new workbench project and start setting up the system. See here, this is opening up a new workbench project. Import the material properties from Sherlock for all the parts and boards, and it will also link the geometry, and finally it will create one mechanical finite element model. This is the step file which is expected from Sherlock, and this is connected to a mechanical model. Then it will open the mechanical model in a workbench mechanical GUI. As you are seeing, this is opening the entire assembly inside mechanical GUI. This is the whole assembly has come in here. Now we can go and look at all the components in this. The PCB board of the PCB 1 is named as board 1, and all the components and the leads associated with board 1 will be prefixed with board 1. This AP stands for the attachment point or assembly point, which we can suppress, and these two boards we can see as we go down, helper 1, helper 2, and helper 1 mount point, these can also be suppressed. We do not need them for any analysis purpose. And also we are having a board 1 parting component, that also is not required. Let us suppress this body as well. Now we have all these parts. Now on top of this, we have to bring the enclosure and parting. So I have a separate CAD model for the enclosure. In order to do that one, we have to add one mechanical system and say this as enclosure. Now I have a CAD model for this assembly here, enclosure as a parasolid file, import geometry, browse. Oops, this is my enclosure. Then I have to also bring in the parting CAD model. So how to create parting, I'm not focusing here. If you are familiar with Space Climb or any other CAD tool, you can just create a block and subtract all the components inside to get the CAD model of the parting. So now we have all this system. So all these need to be assembled inside a new mechanical model. So now we are going to assemble all these three inside this. So now if we come here, the unit system we need to follow is millimeter, and we are going to instruct ANSYS that do not rename any object, because we have all these objects are already having a unique name. As you see here, all the bodies in the CAD model are having the unique name. Now we need to mesh this. I will choose some of the smallest component here, something like this, and say select, or let me choose somewhat relatively a big component, something like this. Size smaller than selection. Let's select all these and say number of element divisions, let's say 2 at least, and we can generate the mesh. The mesh can be refined based on the requirement. I'm just demonstrating the process. This may not be the correct meshing for this project. I expect you to understand what kind of meshing is required based on your end objectives. Then we need to create connections between all these components and say create automatic connections. So this is going to create connection between the different parts and so on. So sometime it may be necessary to go and manually inspect and make sure all the required connections are established, no unnecessary connections between two nearby parts. Once this is done, I can go and set appropriate mesh settings for the enclosure as well, and also for parting. Let me rename this. going to rename this as talking. Let's open this model as well. This is the enclosure. This enclosure is also having, let me hide this, or let me make this transparent. Hope you can see the screwing points here with the holes for both the side. Okay, so while we create the assembly, we have to do some kind of the trigonometric algebra and make sure these mounting locations come and correctly align with the screwing locations here. Again, this is not a correct mesh for this assembly, but however, my objective here is to demonstrate the purpose. Here is for potting. Again, generate the mesh. You can generate what is acceptable mesh based on your analysis end objectives. So here we are going to save this project. Save this project. So two board angle assembly. This is version 2021 R1. I'm going to save this at this location. So those files will be saved here. Now we can right click and say update all upstream components. So these individual system need to get themselves prepared to pass the information to this system, say update components. So this is just going to quickly make sure everything is kind of prepared. Then say refresh. Then say edit. So now we are going to open the final assembly. Fit the screen and let's hide the enclosure for better visualization. See, all the parts are in the appropriate place. This is our potting. We can hide the potting. And if required, we can create a section plane, say show all bodies, and let's create a section plane is passing along this, and look how it is. And we have to also make sure, as I mentioned earlier, the offsets that we give are correctly aligned with the mounting holes that we create. Okay, I think in this case in this example, I haven't used. Yeah, I think it is correct. I think, yeah, there is a mount hole. You look at it, this is correctly getting aligned. Same way, if we go to the other boards, let me see any one of the mounting. Yeah, you look at this, here is one mount point. It's kind of aligned well here. Okay, this is the board, this is the parting region, and the parting region is kind of completely covering this whole stuff. Okay, another thing we need to make sure is that we have suppressed this parting. Workbench Mechanical by default is going to create the named selection for all the part bodies. This is really important for Sherlock to recognize this when we take the RST file back into Sherlock. So we have to, if we go for this parting, we have this, okay, POT, can even use something like POT. This is the name selection, which is already suppressed. So we need to name, we have to create a name selection for this entire parting and rename with this, that is board underscore one POT underscore PR1. Okay, let me remove this. Let me come back here and choose this, create name selection. This is board underscore one POT underscore what was that, PT1, I believe. Let me have a look. POT, yeah, not this, rename POT PR1. Okay, so now when we take the results back, Sherlock will understand this elements as the parting elements, and all the parts in the Sherlock must be a part of some name selection. The enclosure, all components or something like enclosures or connector, which is not really part of the PCB board itself, has to be named as a, created as a name selection. It has to start with other, okay, other underscore, let's say enclosure. So it is important that we are starting with other underscore. After this, after underscore, we can give any name as per our convenience, but when we say this other underscore, these components can be separately visualized inside Sherlock. So this is important. So now we have our complete model ready. Let's say now we want to do a model analysis, create a model analysis here. Then later, if we want to do a harmonic analysis, create a harmonic response here. And all these things are going to keep building up here. If you want to do a model superposition harmonic analysis, then we can connect this model with this setup so that we can do a model superposition harmonic. In case if you want to understand without what is the difference in the dynamic response of the board with and without enclosure, if you want to study the board characteristic alone, we can connect one model analysis here, and we can open this model. We can constrain all these mount point locations. can constrain these mount point locations. Here we can do a model analysis if required, followed by this we can do a harmonic, and we can also do a random vibration analysis and so on. All those things can be done for the board alone configuration or board with enclosure configuration. A couple of other things I want to point out is that let me close the connections. Okay, so now in this case we have there are a lot of connections between the board and the parts, but we need to establish the connections between the enclosure and the board. Okay, so either we can manually go and create the contact between the screw faces and the board face, or we can even create a beam connection between the whole surface in the PCB and this surface. Okay, that is also possible. And same way, we need to establish the connection between the potting and the enclosure, and potting and the board, and potting and the components. Again, we can even use the automatic connection reduction to do that task. Okay, so make sure that we establish the connection between all the parts. This is something like what we do in a standard mechanical. So now you don't want to worry the components what you are dealing with is electronic PCB. Treat them like any other mechanical component. Okay, so now going forward, I just like to demonstrate the rest of the procedure with an example which I have already solved. So here is the model which I have already solved, which I was showing you earlier. So this consists of a model where I have modeled this as an enclosure. This is my potting region, and I have fixed these two ends as I was explaining earlier. The whole thing is connected with a rigid frame here. So as far as the localized PCB is concerned, these two ends are fixed and these two ends are going to see the excitation. So now after solving this problem, we can look at the mode shapes of the boards. There are some modes where both the boards and the enclosure participate together. All those informations can be understood. Then carry out a modal superposition harmonic analysis. In this example, I have shown the frequency range, extracted the frequency up to 650 hertz. So I have limited my analysis from 100 to 500 hertz. This is subjected to a base excitation along the G direction with a uniform 30,000 mm per second squared. This is approximately a 3G condition. But instead of this, one can go and put the actual frequency versus acceleration profile if you need to do, and solve the problem. You will kind of get the results something like this. So once the harmonic analysis is solved, then we can take this RST file into Sherlock back. So open the solver directory of the harmonic analysis Then go to the share log. Here, when we are importing the result, we need to import the results on the master board. In this case, it is helper 1, edit properties, then say imported, browse to the location where we have this RST file, that is the harmonic analysis RST file. Save and run. You can go to a task monitor to kind of understand the importing process. It might take a few minutes depending on the size of the problem we are handling. Here we are importing the harmonic analysis result, but same way, instead of the harmonic analysis, we can also set up the random vibration analysis here. From ANSYS Sherlock 2021 onwards, Sherlock can read the ANSYS PSD random vibration analysis result directly. But in the earlier version, even for the random vibration calculations inside Sherlock, we have to carry out a harmonic analysys from ANSYS Mechanical, which will give the frequency response function to Sherlock. Then the Sherlock will manipulate the frequency response function with the input PSD profile. But whereas from 2021 R1 onwards, Sherlock really needs the random vibration analysis result from Workbench Mechanical. So once the import is done, we can look at the 3D results. Now the 3D results is going to represent the deformation on strain for all the boards which is inside helper 1. But since we have suppressed helper 1 board and helper 2 board, they are not going to appear. Since we have created this other as one of the name selection here, so if we can use this other element, let me plot the displacement. This is the potting region, and we can see the whole results. But once we hide this other element, this is going to remove the enclosure. Now we can also adjust this contour, color info. If you make this as percentage 00, it means it will show the exact minimum and maximum values without adding any buffer to it. Okay, as you can see at 175 Hz, the board 2 is deflecting more. Board 2, it doesn't mean it's not reflecting, it is deflecting, but the amplitude is very less because of the presence of the potting. But if you want to limit the range, we can go to view, color settings, and instead of percentage say exact, let's say 4e-2, and see what's going to happen. It's still showing, I think we have to use 5e-3. 5e-3, then we see these are all above that 5e-3, and here we see the board deflecting. If you want to remove the potting region, we can remove the potting region as well. Okay. And also we can look at the strain results for the entire board. Make sure we go and change the ranges depending on our requirement. Because of the potting here, we see the board 1 is experiencing relatively less strain compared to this one. This is way how we visualize the 3D results inside Sherlock. We can also, we cannot visualize the 3D results of the individual PCB because we need to be visualizing the 3D results only inside the master card. Okay, but if we say view 3D result, it say no, nothing is available, but we can view the layer results. Okay, if we can show the harmonic analysis results for this layer, it will show the layer representation of the results. We can also view the results, which is going to show us the for PCB1, like if you look at all the components are passing, there is no, the probability of failure is very low and all are passing. Okay, no issue at all. But when we come to PCB2 and say view results, we see that some these components are failing because of whatever the excitations we have given. We need to probably take some corrective actions on this PCB 2 to pass the requirement. As this is just a demonstration problem, these numbers may not mean anything to you, but this is the whole process of analyzing multiple PCB boards using ONSYS Sherlock and workbench mechanical combination. I hope this gives you an idea of analyzing different configuration of boards as per your requirements. Thank you.